Greetings, dear aspirants. Welcome to today's current affairs session of Civilspedia. Today we'll be discussing about LEAP and ARPIT schemes of the Ministry of Human Resource and Development, about the Point Calimer Sanctuary, and about the Changi Naval Base under the prelims topic, and about the cooperative federalism under the mains topic. Let's move on with the first topic, the schemes of the Ministry of Human Resource and Development, LEAP and the ARPIT. When we are studying about such social sector schemes, I've already given a template to what are the keywords that we need to focus on. About the scheme, and who are the target audience in the scheme, and what is the impact area of that particular scheme, and who is the agency that is either coordinating or implementing that particular scheme. So let's move on with LEAP and ARPIT. First, we'll look at LEAP. LEAP is the leadership for the academicians program. So the targeted audience is the middle level academicians who tend to become the next head of the departments or head of the institutions. So this is the targeted audience, and this is only for those academicians in the public higher education institutions. And here the impact area, as the topic suggests, is the leadership development. And we need to know who are the implementing agencies. So it is the top 10 national institutes or ranking framework institutions who will be implementing with the help of launching the training modules for these particular schemes. So this is all about the LEAP. Next is the ARPIT scheme. So ARPIT scheme is the annual refresher program in teaching. This target audience is all the professional academicians working in the higher education institutions. And what is the impact area is the overall professional development as a part of career advancement of all the academicians, faculty members. Career advancement. And here the implementing agencies will be those 75 institutions designated as national resource centers who will be developing the training modules and posting it in the SWAYAM portal, which is an e-platform, which is basically a massive open online coaching platform, which has been initiated by the Government of India, by the Ministry of Human Resource and Development. So this is the SWAYAM portal. If you see this ARPIT classes have already been launched since the starting of November. So you can see the topic and what is the hours that the coach, the training would be, and whether it's a free training or a paid training, etc. You can see all the details under this SWAYAM portal. So this is about the ARPIT schemes. If you see, both these schemes are targeted towards those academicians who are the faculty members of the higher education institutions, faculty members. If you see, sometime before we also studied about Spark portal and about Impress portal. So these two schemes of the Ministry of Human Resource and Development targeted towards the research scholars' improvement and the well-being. But this is entirely for the academicians. So this is all about this scheme of Ministry of Human Resource and Development. With this, we are moving on to our next topic. Point Calimer Wildlife and Bird Sanctuary. So when we are studying about wildlife or bird sanctuary, the keywords that we need to keep in mind are the location of the sanctuary, and if any river is flowing across the sanctuary, what is the habitat that is in that particular, present in that particular sanctuary, and if there are any animals or birds present in that sanctuary, which are the prominent animals and the birds, and if that particular wildlife sanctuary or the bird sanctuary has been designated as Ramsar site or an important bird area. So Point Calimer was in recent news for the past couple of months for varied reasons. One thing was for the migratory birds issue. The other thing was for the animal blackbuck, which is present in this particular Point Calimer sanctuary, and also regarding the ecology of the Point Calimer Sanctuary. So let's move on to the location of the Point Calimer Sanctuary. It is located in the Nagapattinam district of Tamil Nadu state. So here it takes a 90 degree turn from Bay of Bengal to the Park Strait. So it is very strategically and also ecologically rich located wildlife sanctuary. If you see the habitats in this particular sanctuary, this sanctuary is one of the last remnants of the dry evergreen forest. So dry evergreen forests are present in the sanctuary. This sanctuary is also rich in mangroves across the along the coastlines, and it also has got tidal mud flats. It has also got open grasslands and wetlands inside the sanctuary. And if you look at what is the river present in the sanctuary, it is Koraiyar River. It is a very minor river which is fed with water only during the northeast monsoon. So this is not of much importance. And you need to know what are the prominent animals and birds present in that particular sanctuary. As I told, this sanctuary was formed because of the abundant presence of black buck. So black buck is the most prominent animal present in the sanctuary. You also have spotted deers, black knap hares, and Indian jackals present inside this sanctuary. And you have also got those migratory birds which come for wintering in Point Calimer sanctuary. So this sanctuary is also a part of the Central Asian Flyway. So some of the prominent birds that can be spotted in the sanctuary is the greater flamingos, the seagulls, painted stork, and the spot-billed pelicans. And this sanctuary has also got a rich flora of medicinal plants. So this sanctuary is also designated as a Ramsar site in the year 2002, and it is also an important bird area as per the template that I shared. So you also need to know regarding the recent news about the man-animal conflicts and the ecological threats to the sanctuary. So there was a man-animal conflict issue and the ecological threat. So there are industries located nearby and the location of salt pans adjacent to the sanctuary, because this is located near the coast. If you see, there is an industry located here and there are also salt pans located here just near the sanctuary. So whatever industrial runoffs and the salt pan runoffs get drained into this particular sanctuary because this is the drain off region. Because of this, the salt concentrations have highly increased in numbers, affecting the eggs of those migratory birds which also come for laying eggs here. So now the migratory birds population has highly started to dwindle. So this is all about the Point Calimer wildlife and the bird sanctuary. Now let's travel from India to Singapore to study about the Changi Naval Base. So about the Changi Naval Base, it is located in Singapore. And now India has got access to the Singapore Changi Naval Base for refueling and logistic support of its naval ships. So this is the first news. In order to counter China, now India is strategically getting access to many of the neighboring countries that are surrounding China for accessing their naval bases. And the second news that was is now the India and Singapore have started their bilateral annual SIMBEX naval drills. So this happens once in a year. This year it's happening in Andaman and Nicobar Islands in the Tri-Command of the Andaman Islands in India. And next news was, is India's necklace of diamond complete now? Because of the strategic location of this particular Changi naval base. It is located in the Malacca Strait. Now around 30% of the world's ship cargo trade happens through this Malacca Strait, and hence it gains strategic importance. And now all the countries wants an open Indo-Pacific region. We also know about the South China Sea dispute, so let's not discuss about that. Now here our point of focus is the string of pearls strategy of China and the diamond of necklace strategy of India. So let's move on to that. What is the string of pearls strategy? So basically it's a strategy of China to encircle India completely in the sea region. So it has now got access to the naval bases present in Myanmar, Kyokpyu port in Myanmar, Chittagong port in Bangladesh, Hambantota port in Sri Lanka, and also a naval base coming up near the in Maldives near Mali. And it's also developed a Gwadar port in Pakistan, and also it has got a naval base in Djibouti, which is the Horn of Africa. Now to counter this, India has also got a diamond of necklace strategy. If you see here, India has now got access to Sabang port in the country of Indonesia, to the Changi Sea port in the country of Singapore, and Dukum port of Oman in the year 2018. So please remember all these three naval bases, because this is a recent current affairs. And now in 2016, India has also got access towards developing the Chabahar port in the country of Iran. And now it is also in talks to develop the Assumption Island in the Seychelles for accessing the naval base. And apart from this, India is also strategically orienting itself, engaging itself with those other countries apart from those present in this Indian Ocean region. If you see, in 2015, India engaged with Mongolia by giving $1 billion credit. So with the help of this, Mongolia, which is a landlocked country between Russia and China, can develop its own oil refinery in order to reduce its dependence, over dependence for its oil from Russia and the China. And also India has tied up with Vietnam in order to supply the BrahMos missiles for its strategic importance towards China. And India and Japan are natural allies. So now they are together started to develop the Asian-African growth corridor. This is one thing. So apart from those three bases developed in 2018, India has also developed or in the process of developing these bases, and about India's strategic cooperation with rest of those neighboring countries of China. So this is all about India's multilateral engagement to counter the China's string of pearl strategy. Now India's moved from its non-alignment policy to multi-alignment policy. This is all you need to keep it in mind. With this, we are moving on to our main topic, cooperative federalism. Today, I'll be discussing about what is the difference between federalism and cooperative federalism, some examples of cooperative federalism, and what are the burning issues with respect to cooperative federalism, and excerpts of today's editorial from the Hindu newspaper. So let's study what is federalism. So it is a division of powers between two governments, one at the center and other at the state, between two tiers of government. Now this federalism can either be rigid or flexible. So rigid in the sense complete separation of the powers between the center and the state. For one good example is the USA. Now flexible, if you see, it is called as the cooperative federalism, which is our topic of study. So now the center and state will engage towards developing common policies for the benefit of the entire people of the that particular political setup. If you see in USA, different states have their own constitution, have their different policies towards the same issue, same one issue. They'll be having different policies. But in India, it is mostly a common policy. So cooperative federalism has also been enshrined in the Constitution of India. So we'll be seeing some examples of cooperative federalism. With respect to different arms of the government, first we'll see the legislature, next we'll see the judiciary, and next the executive functions. If you see with respect to legislature, Schedule 7 of the Indian Constitution, which is nothing but the concurrent list, it's a perfect example for cooperative federalism, where there are some items in the list pertaining to both the states and the center. So separate laws can be enacted with respect to that particular item in the list. And if you see judiciary, it is an integrated judiciary, which will interpret all the legislations of both the center and the state. This is again a classic example of cooperative federalism. If you see in the executive, we have got interstate councils. Interstate councils, which is chaired by the prime minister, and the members are the chief ministers of all the states and the executive heads of the union territories. So this is a classical example. Apart from this, we also have institutions like Niti Aayog, All India Services, Finance Commission as a classic examples of cooperative federalism. Now we need to know different phases of cooperative federalism in order to know what are the burning issues of cooperative federalism at that point of time. So there are three phases of cooperative federalism. The first phase is post-independence, from 1947 to 1960s. At this point of time, only one party was dominating the entire national arena and also in the state arena, which is the INC. And one example exception was that Communist Party, which ruled Kerala. Communist Party in Kerala. Next thing is from 1960s to the 1990s time, before LPG era. So if you see here, this was a confrontational federalism. Confrontational federalism. So this was the rule of the first women Prime Minister of India, Indira Gandhi. Where there were over centralization of the powers of the executive in terms of declaring emergency in the states that went against the ideologies of the ruling government at the center. So Article 356. And from 1990s, this concept of cooperative federalism emerged. Cooperative federalism emerged. Because many coalition governments were coming at the center post-1990s, and hence this concept emerged. Now you also need to know the burning issues at then and that point of time. If you see, emergency was one burning issue there. So in 1990s, Bommai versus Union of India case. Where it declared that the center cannot exercise its absolute power on declaring emergencies towards the states that are not working ideologically along with the center. This was one issue. And the recent issue in 2018 is the executive powers, exercising the executive powers of the state government and the executive head in the state of Delhi. So these two are the issues discussed by the author who has written this particular editorial, a reality check on the cooperative federalism. He has given a brief history about these two issues, and now he has started to the third issue about the difference in the taxation powers of the central and the state governments. So he has jotted some four issues with related to taxation powers. So first thing is about the possession of the powers of that particular state versus whatever powers that the state has already forgiven because of the implementation of the goods and service tax by the central government. So now it has foregone some powers like octroi, entry tax, luxury, entertainment taxes, etc. But still it has powers to levy taxes with the help of through panchayats and the municipalities, which is the another level of tier of government, the third tier of government. Second thing is, now it has already got powers to levy taxes on petrol, diesel, etc. But its future is not very well known, because at some later point, this will be subsumed under the GST. And the third biggest issue is about the sharing of taxes. And now there are two different interpretations of the article, which was the 101st Constitutional Amendment Act, with respect to GST. Now, one article tells that the GST Council is empowered to decide over the sharing of taxes between the states and the center. Because this GST Council comprises of the Chief Minister of the states, will have a more say towards the revenue sharing methodology. But Article 271A and 272 tells that the taxes will be shared in the manner as prescribed in the Article 270 Section 2. So, it tells prescribe. Now, prescribe means the Finance Commission. Finance Commission. So, if you see in 2018 mains exam, there was a question about what is Finance Commission in India, about the functioning of Finance Commission, and about the terms of references in the Finance Commission. So, let's not discuss more on that. So, this is one issue. So, now there is a contradiction versus who will prevail. Either the Finance Commission or the GST Council. And now if such a dispute arises, or say if a state is not really happy towards the shares of the taxes that it has received from the central government, there needs to be some dispute redressal mechanism. Now, this particular dispute redressal mechanism has not been achieved with the help of this Constitutional Amendment Act, because this article, Section 11 of this particular article tells that the Goods and Services Tax Council shall establish a mechanism to adjudicate any dispute between the government and the more states, or the government and states on the one side versus some other states on the other side, or even between one or two different states. For example, say between Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Now, shall establish a mechanism. So, as of now, there is no dispute redressal mechanism that has been established by the GST Council. So, this is the bone of content in this particular topic. So the author has discussed at large about the dispute in the taxation powers between the center and the state. So with this, we are winding up our today's topic. Please do like, comment and share the video, and please do subscribe for Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.